Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's 11th meeting of 2021. I've received no apologies this morning. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Mm-hmm. Thank you, we are agreed. And our second item today is an evidence session with the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care on his priorities for Session 6. And I welcome Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. And supporting the Minister this morning, we have Donna Bell, Director of Mental Health and Social Care, and Gavin Gray, the Deputy Director for Improving Mental Health Services, both from the Scottish Government. So welcome to you all. Minister, I believe you've got a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you and to the committee, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to appear in front of you today. I welcome the opportunity to set out my strategic priorities for the current session for the committee. Right now, our NHS and social care systems are under more pressure than they have been at any point in the pandemic. The government has responded with a comprehensive programme of investment and action in our mental health and social care sectors to address these challenges and to build a health and care system fit for now and for the future. That must be one that focuses on people, meeting their needs in a holistic way and informed by their experience. I'll start with a brief summary of my vision for mental health and wellbeing. I want our work to focus just as much on supporting and creating conditions for everyone to have good mental well-being as it does on transforming our mental health services. Our transition and recovery plan outlines the breadth of work that we are doing, containing over 100 actions, and we are determined to build on some of the amazing work that has happened across Scotland during the pandemic. That includes the establishment of mental health assessment centres and the rollout of computerised cognitive behavioural therapy, among countless other things. The transition and recovery plan requires similarly ambitious investment, and that is why it is supported by record levels of funding for mental health. We have doubled the mental health budget compared to the previous financial year, with our core budget now standing at over a quarter of £1 billion, and this includes our £120 million Recovery and Renewal Fund, which is the single largest investment in mental health in the history of devolution. Over £80 million has already been allocated from the fund this year. Of that, £43 million is to improve the mental health care that children and young people receive, including £40 million for child and adolescent mental health services. Additionally, we have committed to increase the direct investment into mental health services by at least 25% and ensure that by the end of the Parliament, 10% of our frontline NHS budget will be invested in mental health. Together, this will be truly transformational for mental health and wellbeing, and we will continue to work with our partners and stakeholders and with people with lived experience to make sure our response continues to evolve as we continue to recover from the pandemic. I see my priorities in social care under three broad headings. Firstly, improving access to care. The pandemic showed and continues to show us that there is a need to significantly improve access to care and support for people, and that work has to be done now. I know, for example, how much pressure unpaid carers are under, and this cannot wait for the National Care Service. So we're committed to overhauling of the current mechanism of eligibility criteria. We're planning to extend the Support in the Right Direction programme to March 2023 with funding of £2.9 million. And we have invested an additional £28.5 million for local carer support. Secondly, we recognise that the workforce is absolutely vital in delivering the ambitions that we have for social care across Scotland. We must ensure that the principles of fair work are adopted across the sector as standard. Improve pay and conditions and career progression for social care workers. And last month we made a step forward by investing in the social care sector to ensure frontline care workers receive a minimum of £10.02 an hour. There remains more to do on that front though. This government is committed to increasing public investment in social care by 25% over the lifetime of this parliament, equating to an increase of around about £840 million. The recent investment to relieve winter pressures will maximise the capacity of care at home services, enable more social work assessments to be carried out, and support social care staff. Finally, we'll be taking forward our commitment to establish a national care service. And we have already consulted on our proposals in this space. The independent review of adult social care was clear. To improve people's experiences of social care, we need to create a comprehensive system that cares for and supports people in a holistic way and that empowers them to thrive. Human rights has to be at the heart of all that we do here. And we will introduce legislation for the National Care Service by the end of this parliamentary year and aim to establish the National Care Service by the end of this parliamentary term. Convener, I look forward to working closely with you and with the committee as we take forward this very important agenda. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. We're going to do your mental well-being part of your portfolio first, and then we'll move on to talking about social care in the second half of your session with us, if you don't mind. I'd like to open the drivers of mental health and the implications of mental health go into a lot of areas in Scottish society. So I'm very interested in how you as Minister with responsibility for mental wellbeing are working across other portfolios. I mean, it comes to mind that it's very important in terms of education, justice, you know, how are you making sure that the drivers of mental health and the response to people with their mental health issues across all government portfolios is taken into account?
Well, that's absolutely vital, convener. And let me give you examples just over the past couple of weeks, some of the cross-cutting work that we are doing. The committee will be well aware that the other week I held a joint debate with Angela Constance, the Minister for Drugs Policy, looking at how drugs policy and mental wellbeing work together. In the past couple of weeks, I've met with the Justice and Veterans Secretary on a number of issues, but primarily our last meeting was looking at what we need to do as we move forward to improve mental health, mental wellbeing services for our veterans community. And again, within the past few weeks, I've met with Jamie Hepburn in his further education role, to see what more we need to do in terms of supporting students, whether that be university students or college students. So this is cross-cutting. You know, the First Minister has made it quite clear to all of our ministers that we should all be working together, breaking down silos and making sure that we are doing our level best for people. While you know I've got overall responsibility for mental wellbeing, I think that every minister in the government recognises that they have a role to play in ensuring that we do our level best for folk as we move out of this pandemic period.
Coming back to the mental health of our population, as you have alluded to several times in your statement during the pandemic, that it might have for many people gone to something that they are managing to crisis point. In terms of the mental health strategy, have you got plans for a review of that, taking into account some of the issues that in the last 19, 20 months have been an issue? Have you got plans for a review?
Well, I think, Convener, at this moment in time, what we need to do is to see what is required in the here and now. Now, many members of this committee will have heard me say before in this role, but also in my previous ministerial role, that the way that we should conduct ourselves in that regard is to listen to the voices of lived experience. So in this past 6 months, I've spent a large amount of my time listening to people out there and their experiences of services at this moment in time. Some of that is good, some of that is not so good, some of it is indifferent. And what we need to do in the here and now is ensure that the best practice that is going out there is exported right across the country. So let me give you an example, because that's, I think, always the best way. The other week, NHS Grampian won an award at the Health Awards for the Grampian Resilience Hub, which has been extremely beneficial for lots and lots of people over the course of the pandemic period and in the here and now. A week past Thursday, was the first time that I'd met anyone from the hub personally. But I've heard a lot about their work by talking to folk with lived experience. And I know, Convener, that you're going to be doing an inquiry very soon on perinatal and infant mental health, which is an area that I have a great interest in as well. Now, I met women in your own constituency, Convener, the other week, Latinum, who are the voices of lived experience of women in that northeast corner of Scotland. And again, you know, they were telling me what was working well, what was not. But, you know, I think everyone there said that the Grampian Resilience Hub was a lifeline for them during that pandemic period. So that is the kind of service, that kind of delivery is what we need to look at ensuring that is happening right across the country. We know that, you know, face-to-face services haven't happened for a long while, so we're getting back to that. But what actually works for people? So for those women, the Resilience Hub worked for them. So let's see what we can do in exporting that best practice beyond Grampian to other places, pick up that good practice and do our level best for folk right across the country.
Thank you for that. And I guess in terms of the nuts and bolts of the legislative programme, is there anything that you want to flag up that's happening in your portfolio with regard to mental health in legislation?
Well, I think there's a number of things going on at this moment, as there always is. There is the Scott Review at this moment, looking at the legal aspects of how we deal with folk with mental health difficulties. That is going to be very, very important. As always, there are folks who are saying that we need to look at various bits and pieces of legislation, and connected with the Scott Review, there are folk who are saying that we should look at some aspects of adults with incapacity legislation now. But I think we need that review to take place and do all of this in the round. What we need to do as we move forward, and I mentioned it in terms of my opening remarks, is that we need to take a human rights-based approach to all that we're doing as we move forward. I know that many of the folk around this committee table have taken a great interest in embedding human rights into legislation. There must be more of that, no matter what the challenges posed by the court case that the UK government brought to the courts about previous attempts by the Parliament to embed human rights. We've got to continue on in that vein. That's very important. That Scott review is very important in that regard, as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you. And I think that those answers are a good basis for me to go to my colleagues who are going to dig in some deeper into some of the issues that you've mentioned. We have got Evelyn Tweed. So I'm looking for Evelyn. She's normally sat on that side. She's now sat on this side. Evelyn.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Can you share with the committee what effect you think COVID has had on the well-being of Scotland's population?
I think it's had a huge impact, and, you know, talking to folk on a regular basis, for some, the situation has been quite horrendous in terms of the differences that it has made to their lives. I think, you know, we have all faced the stress of the pandemic period. For some, that has been much worse than others. For those that have lost income, those folks who have unfortunately been bereaved during the pandemic. And, you know, for some, you know, some of the lifeline things that they were able to do before that kept them in fairly good fettle went by the wayside in terms of the lockdowns. So I don't think that we can underplay at all the impact that the pandemic has had on people right across the country. And we can see from the survey work that has gone on over the piece that almost everybody has been affected by what has gone on.
Thanks, Minister. Can you tell us what action the Scottish Government is taking to deal with the long waiting lists that we've heard about?
Well, waiting lists are a worry, and you know, we are taking action on that. I mentioned in my opening remarks the investment that we're making in terms of child and adolescent mental health services, which is extremely important. You know, we can already see in certain parts of the country the difference that investment is making as new folk are being recruited into post. I was in Dundee on Thursday of last week at the youth unit there and was hearing from staff the difference that investment will make. I should say, Convener, in terms of some of the pressures that have been on staff during the pandemic period, you know, that unit and those folks attached to the work of that unit, which covers the north of Scotland, you know, at one point were 19 staff down because of COVID and the pressures around about it. These folks have worked immensely hard during the course of all of this. They have behaved admirably. And, you know, I have to say that they were extremely enthusiastic around about not only the current investment into CAMHS, but also, you know, our ambition in terms of moving to more preventative measures, including school counsellors, our move to putting mental health link workers into GPs, and you know, the investments that we're making into communities. So while the focus is on acute services and waiting lists and waiting times, and I understand that, you know, the best thing that we can do as we move forward is to stop folk having to enter acute services by putting the right preventative solutions for folks in place. And that is something that I am very much determined to do.
Thandesh Gulhani has some questions on the impact of COVID.
Morning, Minister. And sorry, declaration of interest. I'm a practising NHS doctor. The government heat target for starting psychological therapy after referral is 18 weeks, and psychological therapy is absolutely vital to the way that we can deal with patients who have mental health issues. So my first question is, when was the last time the government heat target was achieved?
Convener, I don't have that in front of me. I'm more than happy to write to the committee with any detail that I don't have in front of me today. What I would say to Dr. Gohani, though, is that it is our ambition to ensure that we get waiting times and waiting lists down. But I think that Dr. Gohani has to recognise, that we are going through a very, very difficult period in terms of COVID. Now, I'm quite sure that Dr. Gohani is going to come back at me and say, but some of these problems existed before COVID. And that's fair enough. But that COVID situation, that pandemic situation, has exacerbated difficulties for people and has put a huge amount of pressure on services. What I would say to Dr. Gohani is that we've put in place a national standard for CAM services. And my officials at this moment, in cooperation with stakeholders, including the Royal College, are going to do exactly the same for psychological therapies as we move forward. That's important. And again, we are going to be extremely ambitious as we move forward in all of this.
So I can say that certainly it was even 2017, the targets haven't been met since then. And through COVID, through the amazing adaption and digital appointment that have been offered, it's actually been an increase to 82.7% of people being seen within 18 weeks. So COVID is not the reason that we are missing the targets at all. And so my question really is, how could we improve access to psychological therapies and address the fact that we haven't hit the HEAT target at all since 2017?
So I would disagree profoundly with Dr. Gohani when he says that COVID has not had an impact, because it most definitely has. And I think that, Dr. Gohani should spend some time talking to those folks with lived experience to those folk who are working in frontline services about the impact that COVID has had. In terms of his point about digital services, which I think is an important one, we have, during the course of the past period, adapted quite quickly. And digital services has been one of the things which we have invested in. Cognitive behavioural therapies, for example, which have worked well for many, many folks. And we are going to continue to invest in digital services as we move forward. And that works well for many, no doubt about that. However, there's still going to be the need for group therapies and for individual face-to-face consultations as we move forward. I think there's a lot of learning that we can take from what we have gone through. We are looking at how we can embed some of that learning into services as we move forward to create hybrid situations where that is required. But in all of this, convener, as always, what we need to do is take the person-centred approach and see what is best for the individual. Now, a lot of that is down to the clinicians themselves and what they think is best for a particular individual. So, lessons learned from the pandemic, without a doubt, we will take full advantage of the technological changes that we have made as we move forward in order to get it right for people.
Question from Emma Harper. Just waiting for your microphone to come on.
Thank you, Convener. It's just a quick supplementary question. I know there's been a lot of work around tackling stigma, and because now it's less stigmatised to say that you have anxiety or a mental health disorder, do you think that has contributed to the challenges where now we do have more people that are basically coming out and saying, I have struggles, so that has affected the ability to tackle it? Because I know the government's been doing work around destigmatisation and support for mental health in that way.
We've seen even pre-COVID, over the past number of years, a rise in people coming forward with mental health conditions. And a lot of that, I think, is down to the fact that we are changing the way that folk think about their mental health. And a lot of that destigmatisation is down to a lot of hard work on the part of many stakeholders, but also the amount of investment that the government has made over the Peace and the See Me campaign. So just the other week, in order to ensure that that campaign continues to thrive, the government, and of course this is also down to Parliament in terms of the budgetary process, agreed that we would provide them with £5 million over the next 5 years so that they have the comfort of knowing what they're going to be able to do over the piece. I think it's a really good thing that we are destigmatising all of this, but I think we still have a long way to go. Let's be honest, there's still a lot of folk there that won't discuss mental health issues, won't discuss their own mental health. I think that there are areas where folk are very, very wary still of discussing aspects of all of this, and probably the best example still is an unwillingness on the part of many folk to talk about suicide and suicide prevention. And again, the work that has gone on here in Scotland by the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group has been recognised by the World Health Organization in terms of what we've been doing here. But we need to go further. And that's why, you know, we have said that we will double the suicide prevention budget during the course of this Parliament. But, you know, in all of this, we need to get folk to start speaking about these issues, which are often still taboo. And if I may, Convener, because I know I've rabbited on there for a fair while, but I think, you know, there are a number of organisations and groups who have a major part to play in helping us with this. I went to an event at St Mirren Football Club the other week. George Adam would, of course, say, at the centre of the universe. I don't know if I could agree with that. But they ran a day, and I think, if I remember rightly, it was a seventh year of a conference, which had been initiated by a local lad who had seen some of his own mates die by suicide, who thought enough was enough. That event was immense. Heart-rending, difficult, but, you know, it made people think about what is going on out there, what some folk are going through, and what we need to do to help folk in their time of greatest need. And I think, you know, that community-based approach in some of this is the best way in some regards. Brought a lot of footballers together for a very good competition, but also that message was at the heart, and we need to do more of that.
Okay, thank you. Gillian, do you have some questions on our question, and I'll need to move on to children and young people.
Thank you, Convener. The mental health benefits of social prescribing are well known. Does the Minister have a sense of the impact of the pandemic on social prescribing? As pressure has increased on primary care, do healthcare staff have reduced time to engage with social prescribing?
I think it would be fair to say that time at this moment is precious. And I don't have any evidence in front of me to give to Ms Mackay around about these impacts. I think, you know, these are things that we are looking at very, very carefully. I know that Ms Mackay has got a great interest in data. And, you know, I have freely admitted to the Chamber that some of our data collection is not the best. And in some regards, there's a duplication of data gathering, not by the government, but by a number of agencies. And we need to, I've called it a stock take. We need to do a wee stock take, a wee audit. And that's one of the areas where we probably do need to do a little bit more. I don't want to preempt Ms Mackay's next questions, but she knows, because I've answered questions in the chamber that, you know, we're also lacking in data around about certain minority groups, which we need to do much, much more work on as we move forward.
Okay, thank you. Can I come to Carol Mochan, who has questions on children and young people's mental health?
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and thanks, Minister. So Children and Young People Services, I know you mentioned briefly around CAMHS, but I think it is a very important area for the young people and their families. And of course, we do know that the waits have been quite long. But in general, in terms of CAMHS services, I wondered if you could give us some information about sort of three aspects. So the waiting times, which you've touched on, which we really need to get right for people and get these waits down. Also, there are a number of rejected referrals in CAMHS services, and as a government, you have acknowledged that and said that more work needs to be done and what can be done for those young people. And then the third aspect, I think, is around unmet need, because we do know, with the schools being out and COVID, that we had a drop in referrals to the CAMHS services, and medical staff have identified that as possibly young people who missed that window, and we should make sure that they are getting any support that they need at this time.
Convener, I know that Ms Mochan has a real interest in community-based services and preventative measures, and as I said earlier, I want to move much more to that so that folk don't have to enter into acute services. But let me give you a wee flavour of the CAMHS situation at this moment. And I have to say, you know, some of these statistics are not brilliant. Some of them are shows that things are on the move without a doubt. And what I would say is, in all of this, for each of those statistics, each number is a person, and that person also has a family, and we kind of forget these things, and I certainly won't be forgetting these things as we move forward. During the course of this past quarter, 4,552 children and young people started treatment during that quarter. Those statistics were published on the 7th of September. That's an increase from the previous quarter of 4,096. So that's up 28.3% from the same quarter in 2020. So we are getting back to clinicians being able to see more folk, and that's a good thing. But we still have a way to go. So 72.6% of CAMHS patients started treatment in 18 weeks in that quarter. That is slightly up, ever so slightly up, from the previous quarter, which was 72.4%. But it's up dramatically from the same quarter in 2020, which was 61.7%. But we have to understand, you know, there was a massive impact with the pandemic at that time. 10,193 children and young people were referred for CAMHS in that quarter. That's an increase from both the previous quarter, and which was 7,883, and in the same quarter in 2020, that was 4,052. So again, as you've already pointed out, there was a dip during the course of the pandemic of folk being referred. 22.2% of referrals to CAMHS were not accepted. That was similar to the last quarter. And I know that Ms Mochan believes that there should be more interrogation of that. And I agree with her on that front. And we will look at all of that as we move forward. Now, convener, that gives you a flavour. I've got a lot more in front of me here, but I'm sure you don't want me to take up a huge amount of time with all of that. What I will do, though, if you wish, is to send all of that to the committee in writing so that you have all of the information at your disposal.
That would be very helpful. Carol.
Yeah, I mean, can I just ask a wee bit more about the sort of unmet need, if you have a plan or if you've spoken to any of the organisations about what we might be able to do to identify any young people that have been missed?
So, you know, in all of this, I see it as my job to make sure that we're doing our level best for everyone. And, you know, I make no bones about the fact that I think that long waits are unacceptable. And we, as a government, remain committed to meet the standard that 90% of patients begin treatment within 18 weeks of referral. Now, convener, I'm going to be a little bit parochial for a minute, and I hope folk will excuse me. But, you know, when I was first elected to this place, I have to say that CAM services in Grampian were pretty poor. And I used to get a fair amount of correspondence in my mailbag, in my inbox, around about that. CAM services in Grampian were transformed. Yeah. And, you know, even during this period, this very difficult period, I've had no real complaints about CAMs in Grampian. And if you look at what has happened there over the course of the pandemic period, you know, it's been pretty stable there given the circumstances. That transformation made a real difference in terms of service delivery, much more community-based, and, you know, less reliant in some regards on the end acute services. Now, we have the ambition to ensure that that change happens right across the country. And it would be fair to say that different health boards areas are at different levels in terms of making that change. The concentration that I have made is speaking to health boards who have not made the shift that they have yet. Because, you know, in order for us to meet the need, we're going to have to make those changes. It would be fair to say that quite a lot of my time has been spent talking to health boards, challenging them around about what can they do to meet to make that change. Now, some of that maybe not so easy at the moment. Some of it should be easy to do now. And would make things much better for patients, but also much better for staff. And, you know, I'm more than happy again, convener, to give the committee, you know, in writing the standards that we've set around about this and the ambition that we have, and even down to, you know, who I have been speaking to, if that's what you require.
Again, very helpful. Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan on young people?
Thanks, convener. A couple of wee questions there. Thank you, Minister, for being here this morning. I wanted to ask you a little bit more about prevention. You mentioned earlier on about school counsellors, about the GP mental health link workers, etc. there as well. From the prevention point of view too, you know, we've heard quite a lot of evidence around different topics in here about how it can be quite difficult for the professionals to focus on prevention, and I'm wondering what measures you're looking at putting in place there to see what the impact of that is, to make sure that it is prioritised on the ground.
Well, you've picked a good example of prevention and trying to keep folk out of acute services, because I think the school counsellors, quite new, are already making a difference. And, you know, there was a report published, oh gosh, don't hold me to this time at the moment, I'm not so sure about, a month, 6 weeks, 2 months ago, around about what the school counsellors were finding, what difficulties young folk were coming to them with. It gave details of referral, and that's not necessarily to just acute services, but also, you know, I was getting pen pictures of, you know,
the other things that were going on in terms of signposting young folk to the right help at that point. And for some young folk, you know, the listening ear is enough, you know. Somebody recognising, you know, that they have a challenge is often all that we need in this life, you know. How many of us actually go to somebody and say, you know, this is my problem at the moment, and telling them that wee bit of advice, that's cathartic in itself and can be immensely helpful. But, you know, in terms of the huge amount of work already that's going on in that service, it's quite incredible. Again, convener, we can provide the committee with the links to that. It is public. I'm looking at Donna. It is public.
It's how it's been rolled, how the counselling has been rolled out across each local authority, because obviously it'd be good for us to all, as individual MSPs who are obviously speaking to our local authorities, to see where everyone's at in terms of this.
And each local authority has done things slightly differently, convener. And I think, again, we've got a lot of learning from that, because we'll be able to see, you know, where performance is maybe better. Again, you know, export that best practice so we can share that. The other aspect of prevention is that we provided local authorities with monies for prevention work with young people. And again, that's something that I have been keeping a very close eye on. I think that some local authorities have moved very quickly in supporting services, establishing new services where required. Others are lagging behind, and there are a few local authorities that I'm afraid to say have not done very much at all. That's something, again, that we are keeping a very close eye on, because I want to ensure that those investments are reaching particularly the community groups who, you know, were at the very front line during the course of the lockdown periods, still are at the front line, who, you know, have done great work in preventing young folks from entering acute services.
OK, we need to move on. I've got Health Inequalities, Sue Webber.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, hopefully this will follow on quite nicely from what Ms Callaghan was saying and Ms Mochan there. You've spoken, I want to chat about or ask you about the health inequalities across Scotland, and you've already mentioned the established and successful CAMHS service in Grampian, whereby in Lothian it's quite a different story for the many young people that are trying to access services. And then the rolling out of the counselling is done quite differently across local authorities. Some are lagging behind, some are doing very little. But I think as a taxpayer, I suppose we want to make sure that every single penny that we spend is being spent well and is being spent on the intended purpose of the investment. So what actions are we taking to really address those inequalities in delivery of the mental health services across the country?
Well, you talk about inequalities in delivery, and I'll come to that in a second. But population health inequalities, as I've said before and I'll continue to say, The main driver of health inequalities, including mental health inequalities, is poverty. And I think, you know, we all have to recognise that that is the case. And some of the difficulties that people face at this moment have been exacerbated by some of the decisions that have been taken in recent times, including the cut to universal credit, which has had a major impact on individuals and families right across Scotland. Now, I won't go on too much about that, because I could go into a rant that would last all morning, let's be honest with you. Let's look at the difference in delivery. I spoke earlier, convener, around about the standards that we have put in place for CAMHS. And my expectation is that right across the country, those standards, high-quality standards, are met in terms of delivery for people. That is one of the things that we need to do. And Ms. Weber is right. There is a stark difference between delivery in Grampian and Lothian. And it is the way that the services are delivered. And, you know, we need to move, transform in the right way to do our level best for folk and follow the example that has happened in the northeast of Scotland. And those standards, you know, in CAMHS, I think, are already making a big difference in terms of the thought processes of some as well. But we need to go further. And that's why officials, along with stakeholders, are now working up new standards for psychological therapies. And we will be doing similar in other areas of business too, so that everybody knows what is to be expected, whether that's those folks delivering the services or those folks who are in receipt of services. Beyond that, convener, in all of this, and I cannot emphasise this enough, where services are working well, and I'm not saying perfect, but where services are working well, what you tend to find is that the voices of lived experience are at the very heart of the shaping of those services. Now, that's where we need to get to. We need to be listening much more to the service users and their input in terms of what works for them and what doesn't. And I think if you go and talk to folk in Grampian, in the main, I say, not perfect, and folks will without doubt have their gripes and say that this didn't work well for them. In the main, you know, folks have a good feeling about that service that they have been listened to. Yeah. Alternatively, on the other hand, you know, bigging up Grampian in in that regard, and I might be accused of parochiality, so let me say that, you know, in terms of perinatal and infant mental health, Grampian have not done so well at all. And, you know, I think a lot of the reasoning for that is that the voices of lived experience have not been at the heart of that. And I'm sure that you will find out more about some of these things in your inquiry. And again, you know, in terms of that aspect, other areas of the country, Lothian, do very well in that regard. And Grampian in the north, mm-hmm. not so well.
And so, you've hit upon something as a committee that we want to do is we want to speak to people that with lived experience as well on our inquiries. Can I come back to Sue, who has some more questions?
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Minister. It's just a very brief one, I suppose. I mean, we have only 13 health boards, but many more local authorities. So with such a small group or cohort of healthcare providers relative to elsewhere, I suppose, what can the Scottish Government do now to make sure that the process and the best practice, like Grampian, we'll just keep that in, is rather than just speaking about it's great in Grampian, perhaps not so in Lothian, why can't we just be much more forceful about prescribing best practice so that it's implemented consistently across the country?
Well, I think I've answered that in my questions this morning in terms of standards. You know, set standards now for CAMHS, set standards next for psychological therapies, and we will move on. And, you know, that gives folk that framework, that foundation of what is expected of them in terms of service delivery for the people in each of these areas. And it also gives the service users, the patients, the knowledge of what should be expected.
Yeah, thank you. Can I move on to questions around healthcare workers in the mental health sector from Emma Harper?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning again, Minister. As a registered nurse, I've been participating in vaccines and hearing from colleagues directly about their how they've been coping or not coping with their mental health. And I know there has been a lot of work taken forward with the National Wellbeing Hub and Clear Your Head and different programmes to support the healthcare and social care staff. So I'm interested, Minister, in how are we monitoring and evaluating the way that these programmes are being engaged with?
I think, you know, the proof of the pudding here is in the eating in terms of what we have done here. We know that staff are accessing mental health wellbeing hub and the other services around about it. As the committee knows, we've invested more money in there. However, you know, it would be fair to say, and it goes back to your point earlier, around about stigma, some staff feel stigmatised in using these services. Now, we have got to get folk over that hump. And, you know, talking to folk in health and social care, you know, I've been saying all of the time, we must continue to signpost these services. At times, we must cajole folk to going on and using those services. And once folk do, you know, I think it can make a real difference. In some cases, in a fairly short time, not in every case, obviously. But, you know, talking to somebody the other week who had used the services, you know, even those initial calls, they felt, in their words, the burden had been lifted. And folk are under a lot of pressure. Those services are there. I want them to be used. But I think it's absolutely vital that all of us, whether it be in this place or whether it be out there on the front line in health and social care, whether that be within the NHS, within health and social care partnerships or in third sector organisations, we must all be highlighting that that is there. And that folks should access it if it's needed. And I think all of this shows still that we've got a lot of work to do in terms of destigmatising some of this.
I know that we've asked our NHS and our social care staff to obviously work through this unprecedented times and often in unfamiliar settings as well, and many have been asked to learn new skills and work in new roles and in unfamiliar teams, for instance. So I'm interested also, are we tracking how mental health impact might I suppose retain the staff so that we can address all of that so that we don't lose our staff because of poor mental health?
Convener, I'll maybe write in some more depth around about the detail of access of the mental health wellbeing hub and other services and give the committee an indication of what they are doing and what kind of difficulties folk are coming to them with. I think in answer to Ms Harper, without, you know, giving her maybe the in-depth statistics that she wants here. You know, I'm spending, as I say, a lot of time speaking to folk in the front line. And it's quite clear that a lot of folk are under a lot of strain. Sometimes that's because of work. Sometimes that's because of the home pressures because of the pandemic. And there are a lot of different things going on out there. And what we all need to do and to be aware of is that there are folk out there who are not feeling at their best at this moment. And, you know, we as a government, but also as individuals, need to do what we can to support people in the best ways. Now, you know, we've had suggestions from staff around about some of the wellbeing issues that we've acted upon because, you know, why would you not if a difficulty is highlighted to you? And that increased investment that we've put in is because it was suggested that we needed to go further in some instances. beyond that, you know, there are individual health boards as well who have gone even further in terms of meeting the needs of staff during these times. You know, I know that Fife, for example, I think had a substantial donation from a member of the public, which went in to supporting staff. And sometimes those are the most simple things, you know, free hot drinks, free food. You know, all of this can make a difference and take pressure off. So, you know, I'm open to suggestions around about this, as is the Cabinet Secretary.
We have a short supplementary from Gillian Mackay before we move on to questions from Paul, who's going to be talking about suicide prevention. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, during the pandemic, there have been times where staff may have been the only person with someone who was dying and was there with people whose loved ones couldn't get in to see them during lockdowns and things. So that is probably quite a traumatising event for some of these staff. Yeah. As part of the Wellbeing Hub, is there any specific support for people who may be feeling those particular situations?
Yes, and you know, you hit upon a really good point, because some folks have seen some very traumatic scenes happen before their eyes, and you know, I've heard some pretty bleak stories from folk as I've been doing the rounds and talking to folk, and we have to ensure that we do our level best for, you know, a number of folk have seen difficulties, deaths in the past, but for many this has been so much more. So I think we have to take cognizance of that and wrap around the support that's required.
Thank you. Can I move on to questions from Paul O'Kane?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. And I appreciate the Minister has touched on suicide prevention in previous answers, and those were very informative. But obviously, at the moment in Scotland, we do have we have an increasing rate of suicide. And indeed, when we take that as a comparator across the UK, indeed, we are higher than England, Wales, Northern Ireland. So I think my kind of first question would be, are we engaging with other parts of the United Kingdom to understand perhaps their experience and what has been done there? What innovation? How can we share best practice perhaps as well? Notwithstanding the work that I think is going in already, you know, I think where can we learn from other people as well?
Thank you, Convener, and I thank Mr. O'Kane for his question. Let me be brutally honest with the committee. I'm happy to nick good ideas from anyone, anywhere. I think that some of the things we're doing here are pretty groundbreaking. I think we owe a debt of gratitude to the National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group, as I said earlier, recognised by the World Health Organisation in their most recent report. That's a report that's worth reading. There's some good tips from across the globe, you know, that, as I say, I'm more than happy to nick as we move forward. We had a very small decrease in suicides in Scotland last year, but one suicide is one too many, as far as I'm concerned, and we have a fair amount of work to do. I should also say, Convener, and I think the committee may be aware of this as well, is that I think that, again, we have a lot more to do when it comes to self-harm as well. And that's why I've said that we will develop a separate self-harm strategy as we move forward. A lot of work has been done by stakeholders, academics here in Scotland on this issue. I think we have more to do, but I think, you know, we can. And my understanding is, and I stand to be corrected, that in moving in that direction, we'll be the first country in the world to move to having a separate but connected self-harm strategy.
Thanks, Convener. I thank the Minister for that answer. I mean, I think we all in the committee would want to also say ourselves with those comments that you know, one suicide is one too many, and to welcome any decrease. Can I ask just about Every Life Matters in terms of the Prevention Action Plan, which was obviously just reviewed in March. And I think the kind of outcome of that review is that perhaps progress has been maybe slower than anticipated in some areas, and I think you alluded to that yourself, that we do need to go further and do more, notwithstanding obviously the challenges we've all experienced through pandemic and lockdown and the exacerbation that has obviously placed on services and people's lived experience. I suppose what I'm keen to understand is how are we going to drive forward to what is, in that plan, a very ambitious target around the reducing the rate of suicide by 20% by 2022? So I think, you know, how achievable does the Minister still feel that target is, and what further actions does he feel we need to take to get there?
I think, you know, there are a number of things that we need to look at. I talked earlier about doubling the budget over the course of this Parliament. And I think we have to make sure that every penny spent is well spent. We've got two pilots going on at this moment in time, in Ayrshire and Highland, around about support for those folks who have experienced suicide. I think the findings from that are going to be very important. That may well lead to a national rollout. I think the other thing which I am really, really keen to explore is how much more can we do in communities themselves. I mentioned the St Mirren event earlier, but there are a lot of small groups that I've come into contact with in recent times who I think are doing sterling work. You know, how can we build upon that? So yesterday morning I met with the trustees, the family of Chris Mitchell, of Chris Mitchell Foundation. And Chris was a footballer whose professional career ended because of injury, who then carried out suicide. And, you know, some of the work that they've been doing with football clubs, I think, could be expanded upon. I think that some of the other work that's going on by the SPFL, I think we should build on. Because, you know, we need to get to certain areas of the population that sometimes normal health messaging or doesn't get to. So I think that we have got to continue to adapt and to think out the box in terms of what's required to get this right as we move forward. I do think that there is work to do. I think we should recognise, though, the immense partnership that there's been between government and COSLA and that National Suicide Prevention Leadership Group.
Just a brief...
I think to welcome what the Minister said there about those grassroots, I think, organisations, which we, I think, all probably have experience of in communities. But maybe just to get a sense of, does he feel that there's a space to help perhaps fund some of these organisations on a more localised level and to move that forward where it's required?
So I think, Convener, one of the reasons why we announced the Adults Community Mental Health Fund the other week is so that these kind of groups can access funding. There's plenty of detail around about that. More will come and we'll share that with the committee. But, you know, I want those grassroots groups to apply. Let's be honest. Okay. I want them to apply. for this fund. That's why it's there.
A supplementary question on this from Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener. You've mentioned a number of times, Minister, about the importance of listening to the voices of those with lived experience. And we've also heard from Paul there that the Suicide Prevention Action Plan from 2018 was reviewed back in March. It stated that the vision is to support our key strategic aims in Scotland, where people at risk of suicide feel able to ask for help and have access to skilled staff and well-coordinated support. I've been contacted by a friend who had two ladies who both tragically committed suicide very recently and had cried out for help many times. Both were looking for access to rehab services. One woman was told that they could not help her because she was not on benefits and looked amazing. She took a paracetamol overdose, went drunk, and died 4 days later, sober. Sorry. Her other friend lost her job of 33 years and was in the system and well known and had asked and was desperate for help. She hanged herself and left her young family behind. They were both able to ask for help, but it was denied. This is the harsh reality of what's happening again and again in our communities. What is the Scottish Government doing now to help these people? Those are suicides that could have been prevented. And I just wanted to make sure that in terms of today, that their life did matter. And I want to let those in those decision-making positions to be able to do something about that going forward.
Mention any kind of particular instances, but if you'd like to respond to Ms Webber.
Well, I think Ms Webber knows that I can't respond to individual cases. That's not possible. But Ms Webber should feel free to contact me around about the situations. But Ms Webber hits upon a point, and it was a point that came up in discussion yesterday morning. And, you know, I think it's something that we need to all recognise and that we need to build in to the action plan, but also in terms of how we deal with folk in the front line. And it was said to me yesterday, you know, that for many folk on the outside, it looks like some folk have got the perfect life.
Yeah.
You know, they're pretty wealthy. They've got a nice house. They've got a good job. We never know the turmoil within. You know, you might have all of those things and still not be happy and still be unwell. So I think the point that Ms Webber makes around about those folks who make judgments based on the externals of that person, that's wrong. And that's something that we have to put a stop to. We have to listen more. Again, it comes back to that person-centred approach. I think there's work that needs to be done there. It's kind of another kind of stigma, is it?
I was going to say that so fits into that stigmatising.
It's another stigma that we have got to get rid of. But, you know, while I kind of comment on the individuals, I get that point completely. And I think it is a very good point to make because it was one that was made to me just yesterday. And I think we've got to get over that, get rid of that stigma too.
Yeah, and there will be people watching this, of course, who have their own lived experience and will find that resonates very much. Minister, I'm letting the session run on, as you can probably see from the clock. Are you able to stay for an additional 15, 20 minutes so that we can give the social care aspect of things a good airing as well? Because we are coming to the end of talking about mental health and our final theme for David Torrance.
I am in
your
hands as always.
Well, that's good news, but I always like to ask. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Primary care and community services. How have pathways to these services been improved since the publication of the Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan in October 2020?
Well, I think there is much that we need to do there. And I touched upon this earlier in terms of our ambition, our vision during the course of this parliamentary term to put mental health link folks into GP surgeries. Now, I know, and others around the table will know, where that has happened already in pilot schemes. That makes a huge difference in terms of linkages. Absolutely no doubt about that. So I think that that will make a big difference as we move forward. And I think, we'll be talking more about that in the very near future.
And the first sector plays a vital role in delivering services. What representation does it have on the governance of bodies of the Scottish Government and NHS boards to provide mental health services?
The third sector representation in some places is better than in others. In terms of how we as a government interact with the third sector, I speak to the third sector all of the time. They're represented on many of the strategic groups and bodies that we actually have. I think it would be fair to say, in terms of health and social care partnerships in particular, is pretty good dialogue and representation, but without votes at the table in health and social care partnerships, and others, not so much.
Okay. And Sandesh, you have some questions on this?
Thank you, Convener. Minister, in your first answer to me, you asked me to talk to people on the front line. Just yesterday, I was in GP talking to patients and staff on the front line. In 2017, we were promised 250 link workers by the end of the Parliament in 2021, and this was backed by evidence given to this committee in 2019. As of a Scottish Government publication in October 2021, only 218 link workers are in post. And most concerningly, there are zero link workers in Aberdeenshire, Forth Valley, Mid Lothian, North Highland and the Western Isles. Minister, why are these five areas without link workers, as we are all aware of the vital role that they play?
I think, as Mr. Gulhani knows, those are not mental health link workers. They are community link workers, and I don't have the detail of all of that in front of me. But, 218, as he said, are in post. I'll write to the committee, or get colleagues to write to the committee around about other aspects of these. But I would say that these are community link workers and not mental health link workers.
Okay. Can I just ask, coming back to this cross-portfolio thing, an accident, an emergency, police, any of the frontline service, what has been the difference in terms of having mental health specialists, and how well covered are those, almost like first responders? I'm thinking particularly of the justice system and police in terms of having that mental health expertise, because often people could be advised to phone the police, but the person's actually presenting with a lot of mental health issues. I mean, what's been the difference there in the last few years?
I think there has been a huge difference in terms of some of the things that we have done in recent times. I think it would be worthwhile you talking to other organisations around about what different interventions have meant in different places. So let me give you an example, because, distress brief intervention work is happening in a number of parts of Scotland. It's been expanded, and we will no doubt roll that out further. And you can tell, if you talk to the folks working in that area, the real difference that can make. So take, for example, the police. Pressure comes off the police if they can get others in to help folk at time of need, rather than officers being tied up often for long periods of time, and a lot of the time not having the skill set, although most of our officers are pretty immense, let's be honest, but not having the skill set to deal with that difficulty that person is facing at that point. So these things make a huge difference. Another example that I've seen not quite so recently is work that went on in Fife at the Victoria Hospital, around about a joint partnership with Shelter, NHS Fife and the government, mainly focusing on the housing aspect but also dealing with mental health is, and you know, getting folk housed and the support took the pressure off the A&E there. So I think, you know, there's a lot of things going on, a lot of learning that we're doing at this moment in time. And again, it's that point of what is working, what's working well, how do we export that elsewhere?
Okay.
And, you know, that cooperation that exists in many, many places, beneficial for all of those organisations, but absolutely immense in terms of outcomes for an individual that is often very vulnerable and in a lot of distress.
Thank you. We must move on to talk about social care. I'm going to bring in Paul Kane.
Thank you, Convener. And I should draw members' attention to my declaration of interest as a serving councillor in East Renfrewshire Council. The Minister before us, this is the first time I think the Minister's had the opportunity to talk about the National Care Service with committee, and I'm sure it won't be the last time, certainly, in the progression of this proposal and legislation. Obviously, we are at the end part of the consultation phase, and I want to really just start my questions by asking about scope. Obviously, the scope of what is in the government's consultation is very different from what was in Feely. It goes further. I think there's been a degree of commentary around that, it's fair to say. For example, Fiona Duncan, who's the chair of The Promise, expressed that she was puzzled as to why Children's Services was in there and expressed, I think, some concerns about how we deliver The Promise if it becomes part of National Care Service almost. I was at the cross-party group on learning disability. Lots of folk there quite concerned, I think, about the consultation scope and about the needs, the particular needs of adult social care getting lost within that. So can I maybe just ask the Minister, what was the rationale for arriving at this scope within the consultation and why has it gone beyond Feely? And you know, how does he envisage the bill looking in comparison at the consultation once we've obviously processed a lot of these responses? Sorry, that's a lot, I appreciate it, but
are you giving me half an hour, Convener? I'll try and be as quick as I can. Obviously, our ambition in terms of the National Care Service is a service that puts people at the heart of the new arrangements so that their care is holistic and enables them to have the life that they want to lead. Feely answered a lot of questions. He answered a lot of questions about adult social care. That was his remit. But he himself said that there were a lot of unanswered questions. Mr. O'Kane talked around about why enhance the scope. You know, if you look at some of the difficulties that folks tell me they face, and I think that Convener, it's recognised in here, transition periods are often very, very difficult for folk. And, you know, that's recognised, I think, in terms of Pam Duncan Glancy's proposed members' bill. So in all of this, we thought, let's ask the questions around about bringing it all together, getting rid of those transition periods, and seeing what folk out there think. Now, I'll be honest with you, Mr. O'Kane mentions learning disability groups being wary about all of it coming together. I've talked to a fair amount of folk for the learning disabled community, and I have to say that a very, very small minority of folk have expressed concerns. I know that for some, you know, change is threatening. But we also have a huge opportunity here to get this right. And that's why, in terms of the consultation, we have asked the questions that we have. And we will look at the responses, analyse those responses. Some 1,300, although some of those may be duplications. We will look at all that we garnered from all of the meetings that were held with folk over the piece too, and then we'll come to a conclusion around about the way forward. We've got to get this right. This is all about people. And I think, you know, some of the responses that I've seen focus almost entirely on people and others don't. But I think, you know, again, what I would say to the committee is, and I'm sure you will over the piece, going out, talking to folk, they want change. People do not feel that the delivery of social care in many places is right. People think that the postcode lottery, which very much exists, is unfair. And people feel that there is a lack of accountability. Now, we've got to get that right. We've got to get that right.
And Paul's right that we will have the minister coming back to go into the detail of this. And obviously the response to the consultation will be... Exactly. Paul, do you want to pick up on anything else?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. And I thank the Minister for that response. And I'm sure he'll be keen to come to the cross-party group on learning disability as well, so I'll book him in for that. However, I think the last comment you made there around people want change, you know, I think broadly my experience of talking to people is that there is a desire for change. I think, though, that's about cultural change rather than perhaps solely focused around structural change. And I suppose my next question really is...
Can I maybe tackle that one? Because that's actually a big question, also. It was a shorter sentence than Mr. O'Kane's previous.
And verbose, if nothing else.
This is not... I know that folks, you know, will be looking at the framework of legislation, the regulation. But Mr. O'Kane is right. There needs to be cultural change as well. Absolutely no doubt about that. There needs to be cultural change. And we need to have that human rights-based approach and listen to what people have to say. That has not been happening in many places across the country. And there are some things that are going on out there, have gone out there, that are absolutely ludicrous, it has to be said, in terms of delivery. You know, the consultation talks about getting it right for everyone, and that's where our ambition should be. But, you know, some of the stories I've heard, you know, you'd think that in some cases it was how do we get it wrong for folk, with silly situations which should not happen. Now, I don't want to go into some depth in case I end up in a situation where I'm identifying circumstances. But we can provide the committee with some of the contributions that have been made at the consultation events, which, you know, quite frankly, are ridiculous. You know, where folks have not been held accountable. So there has to be that accountability in order to be able to change that culture too.
Paul, did you have something else? I'll come to Sue for a quick supplementary.
Just on the point, I think, about, you know, points being made about accountability. I mean, we have had structural change already, I think, in this space around the introduction of integration joint boards, integration of health and social care. I mean, what, 7 years' worth, I think, of work there that's not quite yet, I think, been well analysed. So I'm just keen to understand, local authorities are obviously very concerned about the changes proposed in terms of accountability, because accountability essentially moves to ministers rather than local authorities. So it would be helpful, I think, for committee to understand what discussion is ongoing with local authorities around this, around their role. Obviously, COSLA has been very critical also, so it would be useful if the Minister can explain what discussions he's having, you know, before we get to the publication of a bill.
Again, you know, in all of this, accountability ultimately will rest with ministers. But, you know, what is also important and sadly lacking in various places at this moment is that local accountability. Local accountability is as important, if not more important, than the accountability to the minister, whoever that is, in the chair at that particular point in time. And let's not shy away from this, because you know, there are some folks who say, oh, well, all of this is going to be nationally run. And, you know, we need, absolutely need, a framework of quality standards that are matched right across the country. But this is also about local delivery and adaptability. And, you know, it doesn't matter who is sitting in my chair in the future, you know, they are not going to be running the entire show on a day-to-day basis. So this scenario where, you know, it's diktat through centralisation, not the case. Canopy, because it is about local delivery, and it is also about local accountability. But it's also about a set of standards that folk should expect to be delivered.
It comes back to what you were saying before about mental health. It's like the standards nationally, but also what the people on the ground can expect, no matter where they are in Scotland.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I have to say that some of the anomalies in terms of delivery are really, really stark, where you can be in one place and 5 miles down the road, the level of service is totally different, or in some cases non-existent. People don't think about local authority boundaries or health and social care partnership boundaries or health board boundaries. They think about the service that they need. Mm-hmm. And we have got to get that right across the board, across the country. And that's why this change is vital.
OK, Sue, very short supplementary, please. And then I'll need to move on to questions on winter preparedness.
Thanks, Convener. I suppose that local service being X in one place and non-existent in another is just relevant to what we experienced in terms of the mental health stuff earlier on. So, but in terms of the economic modelling that's going, or is there economic modelling underway to cost the proposals? And I suppose I'm also here looking at this chart that shows the number of care homes in Scotland, for example, are 1,069. 63% of which are in private ownership and 23% are run by the voluntary or not-for-profit sector, which means that the balance of 142 are under local authority control. So there's a lot of numbers there, apologies, but in terms of the economics that might be behind us funding something or the reforms that might be happening, what economic modelling is taking place right now?
Convener, there will be a huge amount of modelling in various areas. And some of that work is ongoing. Some of that work will continue in terms of looking at the results from the analysis. And obviously, there has to be a huge amount of work done looking at those 1,300 or thereby responses and everything else that has come in from consultation events. I can assure the committee that there will be a lot of work going on in all of this, because we have to get it right. I can also assure the committee, as I've done in my previous role, when it comes to legislation, I am happy to come back here as needs be and to deal with these issues subject by subject, if necessary, because that is the way that we get good legislation. You know, I can say to Miss Webber and to everyone around the table that there'll be a lot of hard graft here, because I have a determination that we get this right.
Thank you. Can we move on to talking about winter preparedness in the care sector? Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. So we have our winter preparedness plan for 2021-22, and there's a parallel health and social care winter overview. And I'm interested, Minister, to there's going to be obviously challenges this winter with in a short list that we have in front of us, recruitment and retention, which links back to my previous question, nursing staff in care homes, infection control in care homes, staff wellbeing, services and support for unpaid carers and delayed discharges. So I know there are challenges and it's a complex way to, you know, manage our health and social care system. So I'm interested if you can give us just a brief overview on how the plan will practically assist providers and social care services in meeting the challenges for the sector over this winter.
I don't know, Ken, if I can give a brief answer to that, convener, because Emma Harper there has covered a lot of ground. As the committee is aware, the Cabinet Secretary announced funding to specifically support winter pressures, £300 million. And, you know, there was equity between health and social care on that front. And that includes £62 million for enhancing care at home capacity, £40 million for interim care, £20 million for enhancing multidisciplinary teams, and up to £48 million for that pay increase that I mentioned earlier on. Now, you know, that investment in the plan itself being published does not mean to say that the work stops there. So the Cabinet Secretary and I have been in discussion with a number of health boards, health and social care partnerships, local authorities over the past number of weeks, to hear from them what the pressures and challenges are and to see what other help we can provide. And that will continue as we move forward. This is, without doubt, the most precarious time in the pandemic. In some areas, there is a difficulty with staffing. Often because of COVID outbreaks, often because of other illnesses. And quite frankly, it has to be said as well that many folk in the front line are shattered. They're tired. And we have to take cognizance of all of this in terms of how we get all of this right as we move forward. So, you know, some of those meetings that have taken place with health boards, health and social care partnerships and local authorities together, we've been looking at what else can be done to take pressures off. So that includes how does everybody work in partnership and tandem in terms of reducing delayed discharges. What can we do in terms of that multidisciplinary team approach to plug gaps if there is a COVID outbreak, keeping staff off or other things keeping staff off? How can we plug those gaps? And, you know, there is some good thinking and good action taking place in some places that we're advising other places to consider and to do if necessary. So this is going to be ongoing throughout this piece. Probably Ms Bell has been on more calls than anyone else over the piece, and that is continuing on a day and daily basis.
Okay, very short question, then, and I need to move on.
Okay, thanks, convener. It is very short. It's basically, I know that there will be cognizance of an approach that will deal with rural areas like Dumfries and Galloway and Scottish Borders in my South Scotland region, and that can be a yes or no answer, I suppose, in that question.
Yes. Obviously, some of the thinking has to be different in rural areas than it is in cities. For example, you know, sometimes it's not so easy to plug a gap if there is illness in a remote rural place. So, some places have looked at their expression, not mine, flying squads, so that they can, you know, deal with care at home in certain places where a gap has been created because there may be illness or whatever. So A lot of people are thinking out of the box around about how we do our level best for folk and all of this. That needs to continue, and we need to continue to push that. And what we require, and some of the folk in the calls that I've been on are probably sick fed up of me saying this, is collaboration, cooperation and a lot of communication in order to get this right over the piece.
OK, thanks.
We'll move on to questions about unpaid carers. Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, are you confident that all unpaid carers that require practical or respite support are able to access it?
No, at this moment, I'm not confident that everybody can access respite support. I should say, Convener, that I want to get away from using the word respite as well. I prefer short-term breaks. I think that's the much better way of describing it. And as somebody said to me, respite is often seen as a burden, and we need to get away from all of that. But what I do want to do is to ensure that as we move forward, that short-term breaks become a right. And that's why the National Care Service consultation contained questions around about that, because I do think it should become a right. I think at this moment in time, I'd be telling parties if I said that everybody can access what's required at the moment, because I know that that's not the case. I was talking to carer centres managers only yesterday, and there is a combination of things going on which add to the pressures. Day services have not fully opened up in some areas. Sometimes that's down to space difficulties, sometimes that's where they've been in the past, and we need to continue to open those up safely. Equally, as was said to me yesterday, there are some carers who are still afraid to put their loved ones to daycare services or on short-term breaks because they're still feared about the pandemic. We'll have a job of work, I think, in terms of, as we move out, regaining folks' trust to help them get back into the routine that they were maybe in before. That's going to take a while. So I could not say that we are doing everything to meet the needs at this moment in time, but I think as we move forward, we need to ensure that we are doing that. And that's why, that bit of the consultation is a very important one as far as I'm concerned.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for that, Minister. Can you also outline for committee what statutory services are available to directly support unpaid carers?
Well, there are a number of statutory services under the Carers Act in terms of meeting the needs of carers. We know that in terms of the Act itself, the Act is in terms of delivery is better in some parts of the country than in others. Again, it's this situation whereby we need to make further change. I think the Carers Act is grand. The money that we have given to local authorities, substantial amounts of money, are not necessarily reaching carer services in all of these areas. I think, again, we need to change that as we move forward. That may mean change in terms of the National Care Service legislation. If not, that may mean, looking, and I know the word's not light, but looking at what we need to do to secure that money goes directly to carers and carer centres as anticipated. Ring fencing is the word, because it would be fair to say that in some areas it's not open and transparent where all of our investment is going.
Stephanie Callaghan, quickly.
Oh, thank you, Convener. I think we can all agree, Minister, that unpaid carers are absolutely the backbone, family, friends and neighbours, for looking after people. And there's already been talk about the ethos and the culture, and that really, really having to change. And it's time that we started really valuing caring roles much, much more. You spoke yourself as well about the pressure on unpaid carers as well, saying that they cannot wait. And that's something I would agree with very, very strongly. You've also mentioned professionals in the front line. You know, they're shattered, they're tired. Carers are absolutely in that position as well. They've had to pick up when services have closed. It's not a criticism. At the end of the day, we had to prevent the spread of infection, save lives, if you like, too, there. But that burden has fallen on carers, and it's a very physical burden as well as a mental burden as well there. So I'm wondering, you know, what kind of practical hands-on support for carers, bearing in mind that, you know, they cannot wait, what can they expect to start seeing on the ground right now over the next few weeks there? Because some of them, you know, are reaching a point where they actually cannot cope. They are not going to be able to continue in their caring role unless they get that support. Thanks.
So that, I know that folk can't wait, and that's why we've already put in additional investment. Let me just run through some of that, Convener, if you don't mind. We invested an extra £1.1 million into the Short Breaks Fund, that's the Shared Care Scotland and Family Fund, last year, and £300,000 in our Young Scot Young Carer package to support carers of all ages to enjoy some time away. But as we know, some folk won't do that at this moment, and we need to encourage that. And this year we've already committed an extra £570,000 for the Short Breaks Fund. We also recently launched a £1.4 million Scott Spirit Holiday Voucher Scheme for tourism businesses to sign up to help low-income families, unpaid carers and disadvantaged young folk to take a break from caring. The other thing which I want to do in the short term, and again, we have to have cooperation from partners, including COSLA, is to get rid of eligibility criteria, particularly some of the local eligibility criteria that is cropped up. I think that is majorly important in terms of delivery. And, you know, we know that unpaid carers, as you rightly point out, Ms Callaghan, have seen a decline in their mental health over the course of all of this. And, you know, that national wellbeing hub that I mentioned earlier is open to carers as well. We were talking yesterday, as I said, with managers from carer centres, and while a lot of work has been going on to signpost folk there, I think we still need to do more on that front. We also, in terms of the National Wellbeing Hub, have a dedicated section for unpaid carers, and we're developing with young carers a dedicated page for them, which is on the cards too. So those are some of the things in the short term that we have done, are doing and will do.
I'm about to move on to questions from David Torrance. It's on remobilisation of social care support services, which I do find a bit of an anomaly because nobody's not been mobilised, they've been ultra-mobilised. So that's maybe not the wording that we should be using, but David Torrance, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. The pandemic has seen a reduction in, and even the end to some of the care at home services, and many community-based organisations and third sector organisations have been unable to provide services because of pandemic restrictions, or have even been forced to close. Minister, is there a coordinated social care remobilisation plan, and who are the key stakeholders involved, if there is?
In terms of remobilisation, the folk that we've got involved in that, I'm going to turn to Ms Bell, because I kind of remember off the top of my head who all sits in that for us.
So on the group that was originally involved, there were a really wide range of partners across the NHS, Health and Social Care Partnerships, IGBs, COSLA, the third sector, professional bodies, etc. We're now in the implementation phase of that, so we're working individually with local partnership areas. So again, a wide range of partners locally, so NHS boards, integrated joint boards, local authorities, the third sector, and people, actually people's organisations with lived experience. So the phases are changing and we continue to engage with national bodies, but we're also at the point now where we're engaging with local partnerships.
I think you're right to point out, convener, that, you know, we're talking about remobilisation here, but, you know, folks have put in a hard shift over the course of all of this. Now, you know, some services were disbanded during the course of COVID, but the vast bulk of folk who were in these services went on and moved and worked elsewhere. You know, we owe a huge debt of gratitude to those folks that have kept our most vulnerable folk cared for during these very tricky 20 months. I would say, and I'm sorry for repeating myself, but this is a precarious time that we're at, the most precarious time. It would be fair to say that in many areas there are staff shortages. Some of that is down to illness. Some of that is down to the fact of Brexit. You know, one service I spoke to had lost 40% of their staff who returned to their home countries after Brexit. And that is inevitably going to have an impact. And we know, because I've heard the stories, that other folks have left social care for the moment because they are tired and they've gone into what they see as easier jobs and hospitality. I hope, I think we all hope, that these folks come back. And again, the National Care Service gives us the opportunity in terms of national pay bargaining for these folks, a real hard look at pay and conditions, and beyond that, giving people the opportunity of career progression. And while I say that, I think one of the other things that we all have a duty to do is to recognise that care is a profession. It is a profession. I think we've got a wee bit of education with some folk around about that, but we should continue, and I hope this committee will continue to refer to it as a profession as we move forward.
Those issues came through very loud and clear last week when we spoke to care organisations. Can I move on to questions from Sue Webber on delayed discharge and interim care facilities? Sue.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks, Minister, again. I do understand the rationale for the interim care facilities, but surely it's just going to result in more of some of the most vulnerable people maybe making multiple moves over a short period of time from one facility to the next. And what if there is no care package in the community after the 6 weeks? And if the community care issues could be solved in 6 weeks, why hasn't that happened already? I suppose this is all the stuff that's going around in my brain. The delayed discharge isn't new. I mean, yes, if anything, during COVID, we had some rapid discharges from hospitals into care facilities that we are now looking back a little bit reticent about those decisions. So I'm trying to figure out what happens if those 6 weeks there's nothing there in the community, but also how many people are currently in what's classed as an interim care facility. Where's this data recorded? And are they still then classified as delayed discharge so we can get a sense of how things are progressing?
There's a huge amount in that question. Ms Webber says that it's all buzzing about in her head, but I think it's probably all buzzing about in our heads at this moment in time as well. I explained earlier to the committee about the level of engagement that we are having with partners around about getting all of this right as we move forward. We have a significant amount of folk in hospital at this moment who should not be in hospital, and it's based that they're not in hospital. And some of that solutions will be on an interim basis, but, you know, the ambition here is to get back and folk back into independent living, if that's possible, with the support as soon as we possibly can. Rather than me going on and on about all of the possible connotations, possibilities around about this, why don't we write to the committee around about what we're doing? You know, some of the information that Ms. Weber is asking for at this moment in terms of who is currently in an interim situation, we don't have. So let me write back to the committee in some more depth around about how we're handling all of this.
Thank you. Sue, can I come to Sandesh Gohani and then Stephanie Callaghan? Sandesh.
Thank you. Hospital at Home was first introduced in NHS Lanarkshire in 2011 and shows great results. And Jean Freeman in March 2020 announced £1 million in funding. So my question really is, after 10 years after Hospital at Home was first introduced and after £1 million was invested just a year ago, do 10 boards not have adequate Hospital at Home resources to prevent admissions?
Convener, just recently the Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef announced additional resource for Hospital at Home. I think Hospital at Home is a great way forward. I've had the pleasure of meeting teams recently in Edinburgh and in Lanarkshire. And the Deputy CMO, Graham Ellis from Lanarkshire, has been a great advocate of Hospital at Home. And that's why we're making those further investments to expand it even further, which I think is a good thing.
OK. Can I come to a question from Stephanie Callaghan on this?
Thanks very much, Chair. And just of note again that I'm currently a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council, and I'm also going to mention South Lanarkshire straight after Sandesh has done the same there. I was actually at their briefing on Friday last week, and they spoke of the increase in demand for supported discharge being 30 to 35%. So despite a 30% improvement in discharges from their hospitals, you know, you're looking at a situation where you're kind of standing still there to some degree. I'm wondering as well, you know, the third sector have been absolutely critical in all of this. Is there any particular further support that might be offered to the third sector? Thanks.
Well, some of those solutions have to be found locally. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, we're having the conversations that we are with partners across the country, because we have to mobilise everything possible at this moment to ensure that we are doing the right things, the right thing for folks as we move forward. We don't have the luxury of not involving everyone in all of this. And again, I would come back to the point of collaboration and cooperation, because that has to be between government, local government, health and social care partnerships, NHS boards and the third sector, so that we're doing our level best for everyone in these pretty precarious times.
Okay, thank you. Can I move on to questions from Carol Mockin on the rights for care home residents? Carol.
Thanks, Convener. Really, just to directly ask the Minister, you know, around the rights for care home residents, we all know what happened over the pandemic, but are we at a stage now where the Minister feels that the opening up of care homes to visitors provides adequate access to family and friends to ensure the wellbeing and the health of the residents?
I should say to the committee that every week, I get a report around about how Open With Care is working and where it's not. And obviously there are still some difficulties in certain places with outbreaks. But, you know, Open With Care should allow greater access for relatives. And even if there is an outbreak situation, there are still ways and means that relatives can still access their loved ones in care homes. The committee will know that we've had two consultations on the go, which have now come to an end. I cannot remember how many responses we've had to that.
To the handful Stockholm. I don't have the figure. We can
send you that. We're both losing our memories in this. But there has been a significant response. I should say, convener, that Anne Duke, who Anne's Law is named after, actually passed away at the weekend, and I'd like to give my condolences to her family. We will move forward in Anne's Law. I think it's got cross-party support around about getting this right for people as we move forward. That will be Anne's legacy, and you know, I pay tribute to her daughter Natasha and her husband Campbell for the efforts that they have made in terms of getting it not only right for their own family, but right for everyone in the future.
Thank you. So you wanted to put something on the record?
Yes, thank you, Convener. My apologies for that last question on the theme of delayed discharge. I should have declared that I am a councillor at the City of Edinburgh.
And we now come to the Minister, who will be pleased to hear our last theme of questioning in this extended session with you, which is always going to happen when you come in front of us for the first time, when we go through absolutely everything that's in your portfolio. Can I come to questions from Gillian Mackay?
Thank you, Convener. We heard from the panel last week about the role of golden hellos in recruitment. It was made clear that any such initiative would need to be funded across the board, otherwise some providers wouldn't be able to afford it. Would the Scottish Government consider funding an incentive for people being recruited into social care?
Now, that is a question and a half, because golden hellos, golden handcuffs, I think that is a very difficult thing to do, and it could end up creating more problems than it resolves. I'll be honest with Ms. Mackay and the committee. I am pretty pragmatic in a lot of things, and I don't automatically shut doors and suggestions. It's something that we could look at. But, you know, in some regards, I do not think that this is necessarily a solution.
Gillian?
I just have one other question, particularly on social work. I feel that social workers have maybe been the one area that we haven't maybe discussed on as frontline workers. And like many other services, social work has come under increased pressure during the pandemic. Yet we hear very little about the impact this is having on social workers. Does the Minister have a sense of wellbeing levels amongst the profession and how this may be impacting retention, as we know that the average working life for a social worker is around 7 years?
I don't have the retention numbers off the top of my head, but we'll furnish the committee with that information. I've spoken to a lot of social workers. I spoke to criminal justice social workers last week, but I've spoken to social workers in children's and families and adult services as well over the past few weeks and months. It would be fair to say, like everyone else, there's a lot of pressure on. And I think it's been very difficult at points for them in terms of the way that they work. Particularly during the lockdown periods, but I think that folks have behaved admirably. They've done amazing things over the piece. I think, you know, in terms of conversations with social workers, one of the key messages from them is, you know, empower frontline staff more, and I think that we must do that. I think that social workers sometimes feel the poor relation to other professions, and I think we've got to change that again. A part of the conversation and the consultation, and Derek Feely's suggestion is, do we move to a social work agency? So I think you know, there's that to consider, and we'll look at the analysis there. The one big bugbear of social workers is, again, eligibility criteria, where they feel bound, often by locally set eligibility criteria. And again, that's why, you know, in the short term, we've got to work with COSLA to eradicate some of this, because we're not doing good for people, either the professionals, the frontline staff who know, or the individuals and families that they're serving.
Thank you. I want to thank colleagues for the questions this morning to the Minister and to the Minister and his officials for the time spent this morning. We will, of course, be seeing you many times over the next year.
I'm sure that's the case, Convener.
And we'll be able to, we'll take you up on your offer to come back whenever we want to drill down into any particular aspect. But that's been an excellent overview for us to know what your priorities are for the coming year. And we'll suspend very briefly before we move on to our next item.
of a negative instrument on the National Health Service Pharmaceutical Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2021. This instrument amends the National Health Service Pharmaceutical Services Scotland Regulations 2009 to allow for the provision of dispensed medicines at premises which are not a registered pharmacy. And this is in line with the exception created by the Regulation 248 of the Human Medicines Regulations 2012. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument and raised no issues, and no motions to annul have been received in relation to these instruments. Have members any comments on this instrument? No. I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Any member disagree with this? We're all in agreement. Right, so at our next meeting on 23rd of November, the committee will take evidence on data and technology in health and social care, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.